welcome, Professor Desplat. We're particularly lucky to have JC here today. He's director of the Irish Centre for High-End Computing in Trinity College, Dublin. ICHEC was established in 2005, and JC was instrumental in setting up the centre. He has a very distinguished academic record, you probably see from looking up his work, both on the research and the academic side. And he has been in a number of universities in the UK, including Sheffield Hallam University and Edinburgh University. But today he's here to discuss, as you can see, Beyond Moore's Law, Disruptive Technology, Opportunities and Policy Challenges. In particular, he'll discuss the impending end of Moore's Law, which has fueled many scientific breakups, or breakthroughs, never mind breakups. but this is rapidly coming to an end, as you know. He will argue that we now have to move from a more evolutionary to a revolutionary approach. And he will follow milestones in research in health, bio, aeronautics and climate modelling, but perhaps most importantly for us, ask the question, what next? Thank you very much. We look forward to your presentation.
Thank you very much indeed. Good afternoon, everybody. So today's subject of my presentation is to look at Moore's Law. What is Moore's Law? What actually it means for us on a day-to-day basis in the ICT domain, what kind of breakthroughs it did enable, but also to look at opportunities. And as a final section of my discussion, we'll focus on policy challenges and how to avail of those opportunities, and in my opinion, what structural changes will be necessary to get to this point. So first of all, a not-so-technical overview of Moore's Law, and I need to be careful here because I do realize I have people who know a lot more about Gordon Moore than I would. But this is, behind the name, this is a real man, Gordon Moore, who is now in his 80s. Originally more chemical engineer with his PhD from Caltech. And this gentleman was asked in the mid-60s, in 1965, to speculate on where the semiconductor industry was going in terms of the density of components like capacitors, diodes, and so on over the next 10 years. So he plots that data from 1959 to 65 and noticed that it was roughly a linear progression year on year, and extrapolated that for the next 10 years to 1975, the same would happen. And the editors of the journal actually named this Moore's Law. And it did stick, as you know. And what's remarkable, so the text, I apologize, it's a bit small maybe, but this is 2005. And you notice that these conclusions that were in 1965 still very much applied in 2005, which is the end date of that graph, and very much continued all the way to 2015. Now, we take progress for granted, right? But I think we need to consider what these evolution actually enabled in terms of progress, in terms of computer power. And I'll come to this with a very striking example in a couple of slides. What I'd like to do also is to pay tribute to the people in Intel and competitors, right? Not just Intel, but and for us to consider the level, the pace of progress and what that would represent if we were to consider this in a different domain. And the example used here is in the context of the aviation industry, is that if the aviation industry had followed a similar rate of progress in 1978, we would be doing a flight from Paris to New York in about a second, and that would cost us less than a penny. So that shows you really the rate of progress of that industry is really phenomenal. But also, well, I don't know if you use that term in English, but that's a big French term, a tour de force, right, of the engineering design and engineering team. It's absolutely amazing to look at the level of precision they actually need to introduce in their manufacturing process. Now, I hope to know a thing or two about technology. I still don't understand how they do it. I think it's absolutely remarkable. For me, it's close to magic, right? So what does that mean in the world of technical computing? How do you translate Moore's Law? Because the term, oh yeah, it's in line with Moore's Law, is used fairly frequently. So what we mean by Moore's Law is we experience a linear progression over time, which is very much in line with the one stated by Gordon Moore, So in the mid-60s, it says doubling every year. He revised this in the 1970s, where he was a bit less ambitious, said it becomes a doubling every 18 months to 2 years. Right? This is what we call the top 500. So in the early 90s, a group of computer scientists, American computer scientists, said, we want to have a registry of all the most powerful supercomputers in the world, across all domains, academia, industry, government, whatever you use it for. And we're going to run a standardized benchmark to see who is the bigger one. That's a big concern for American firms. So what you have in red is the performance, which is vertical axis, of the number one supercomputer in the world. The blue line is the number 500, right? And the green line is just the sum of all the 500 computers. And you notice it's pretty much linear over time, right, for the past 20 odd years. And what's so interesting also, it goes faster than Moore's law. It grows basically pretty much every 15 months, you double the level of performance. Right? And there's a reason for this, I'll come to it. But what's very interesting, meet Walton here. Walton was the first national supercomputer in Ireland. That's the first, my first job when I came to Ireland in 2005, was to buy our first national supercomputer and set it up for the academic community back then. That's half of the machine, 7 cabs. Each cab weighs 1 ton. The overall machine cost me €500,000 a year to pay for electricity and cooling. So half the machine is €250,000 per annum. That's a lot, right? A lot of weight, a lot of money. It was 1.1 million for the whole machine, so €500,000 as well of capital. It is the same compute power as the latest iPhone. So only 12 months later, only in 12 months, you have something you can wear on the palm of your hand, only cost you a few euros to keep going, compared to something that weighed 14 tons, right? Cost €600,000, and cost you €250,000 a year to cool and to feed, right? So it brings a sense of perspective. We take technology for granted, and maybe we should do sometimes, and think, is what I'm doing with technology in line with the increased capabilities that technology provides me? Right. What's very important is, one of the reasons why we are outperforming Moore's law is that investments don't remain constant. There is growing global recognition of the economic and societal impact of high-performance computing across most governments in the world. And currently, in fact, there's a global race taking place between Asia, the USA, and Europe is number three. The ambition of Europe currently is to become the number three. Right? But China in particular and the US are firmly anchored in the top two positions, though it might change with the current administration. There's a really interesting policy paper called HPC Europe's Place in the Global Race that outlines the importance of high performance computing for innovation and competitiveness in Europe. Now we were extremely fortunate for our 10th anniversary to have a visit from Director General Roberto Viola, who gave an address after the IAEA, as it happens. We had to share Roberto between our two organizations. And he delivered a keynote for half an hour, where he emphasized the importance of HPC, for example, to understand the functioning of the human brain, to model how the human brain functions, in order to try to better understand, say, the disease of aging, for example, the kind of Alzheimer's disease, and so on and so forth. Commissioner Oettinger is similarly supportive, and I read recently that the Vice President, Mr. Hansi, was also delivering a very important talk last week on the importance of high-performance computing. So if you wonder what the number one in the world looks like, this is what it looks like. It's in China. A couple of statistics which are interesting. First, it's 10 million processing elements. So if you want to use the world power of the world machine, you need to understand how to make these 10 million different little computers to work together to solve a problem. And this is part of the difficulty. But the second number, which is very important, is 15 megawatts. That's a lot of electricity, not only in terms of cost, but in terms of infrastructure to actually support the whole site. This is the last time we are going to see this graph. So, something struck me with Moore's law. Moore's law, in many respects, I think, underrepresents the level of innovation that went into designing those chips. You see a linear curve and you think, Sure, just more of the same. They kept on doing the same thing, kept on going up. It's not at all the case. I mean, our friends in the electrical engineering world, and I should be careful, maybe there are electrical engineers today in the audience, but kept on seeing in the near term, a few years ahead, the limitation of the current process. And they know that in order to keep on pressing ahead, they will need to come with some form of innovation to overcome this barrier. Right? And again, I'm not an electrical engineer, but I know that the Intel guys kept on coming up with new processes to push the boundaries from micrometers to 100 nanometers, to 10 nanometers, and I believe next will be 7 nanometers, which makes you wonder when it's going to stop. But the same is true for high performance computing. Though it was linear, we went through a number of paradigm changes, or a number of, if you want, different approaches on how to solve a problem. So we went from single CPU machines, happy days, easy, keeps on going faster, it's magic. Vector machines, more for engineering, for weather forecasting, so all the big automotive industry and weather forecasting agencies are one of those extensive machines. MPP stands for massively parallel, so we've got a lot of this very small processing elements within a single machine. Then we moved in 2005 the concept of multicore. Right, so most of you might have heard that even your phone or your laptop is dual core or quad core or 8 core. Now we're pretty much at 20 cores plus. And now we are in the mini core era, which is again thanks to Nvidia, Intel, and other manufacturers. We have now little processors or cards you stick in your computer that have literally thousands of processing elements in your hand. Right? So the latest Intel mini core proposition is called KNL, Knight's Landing. Offers you 4 times the power of the iPhone. So I like to parallel with the iPhone because it's interesting to put in perspective. Everybody has a mobile phone. Everybody can understand how much power actually this kind of device is offering. So don't be fooled by the linear curve. Basically, things are a lot more complex than they are. We have to face increased complexity in our architecture. I also wanted to put a friendly cloud because very often we are pitched as bad guys. People try to say the HPC guys hate the cloud guys and the cloud guys hate the HPC guys. And it's not true. I believe in one big happy world. Right? But there is also a sense of misunderstanding, I suppose, of these two technologies. The cloud is just, for me, a delivery mechanism. And I have somebody from Google here, so I need to be careful. Yes, it is a delivery mechanism, and it is true to say that quite the contrary, the cloud is going to democratize the use of high-performance computing by making it more readily available through public cloud services. So you look at Microsoft Azure as one good example of a cloud with good HPC resources available. But one thing is true, though, is that debugging, fixing your code when it fails, called debugging, or optimizing your code, making it go faster, will be more difficult within the public cloud than it would be if you got a machine in your own data center. So it was a call for anybody from Department of Jobs, if we have somebody from Department of Jobs or Education, our co-founders, that don't be fooled, HPC centers are going to be required even more so within a cloud world. I'd like to say thank you to our friends from Accenture Labs. So one of the great meetings within the 10th anniversary, we had the honor also of getting somebody called Mark Carl Billiard, who is a global managing director for innovation. And he and his team, and he got me truly inspired about quantum computing. What's next? What's after conventional computing? And they actually authorized me to use some of the materials I'm going to publish very shortly in a forthcoming report on quantum computing. But I think it put it in a very interesting context. We get a bit too bogged down with those blinker 1970s to whatever 1980s to 2015. We need to go back to the early days, right? First computers to the next generation. What's coming next after conventional computing? And this is quantum computing. Now, what is quantum computer? Well, first of all, I think it's a piece of you appreciate the quality of the engineering, it's truly fascinating. This is the actual infrastructure that goes around the chip, and this is part of the cryogenics, part of the world cooling infrastructure. It's actually truly fascinating. This one comes from D-Wave. I think we had one of our co-founders and chief scientific officer actually came to visit us last year or 2 years ago as part of the Bell Days in November. It was a very interesting presentation. So a few points very quickly. Yes, it is a genuinely disruptive technology. This terminology, in my view, is used far too often incorrectly. Second point, it's not a panacea. Quantum computing will not replace mainstream computers. It's not to be used for general purpose, right? But it's particularly well suited to address a number of classes of problems, optimization sampling, and machine learning over a very broad range of verticals. So it will coexist with conventional systems. And again, what I put here in double quotes are quotations from the actual report I mentioned earlier. As such, it is unlikely classical computing will be replaced anytime soon by quantum computing. And our friends also forecast that consistent enterprise use is only 2 to 5 years away from one class of quantum computers called adiabatic. It is a category of systems D-Wave are manufactured. 2 to 5 years from now, sorry. So I don't know about you, but when autonomous vehicles started coming on the road, I didn't realize they were already on the road being tested. When I'm being told quantum computers are already in use, yeah, I thought it was just some kind of 10 years down the line. I didn't realize initially that this technology was actually so close from being used for operational use. That's absolutely fascinating. And that demonstrates a need to be extremely agile, right? That in terms of policymaking, when opportunities like this come, you don't have the luxury to spend 2 years thinking about it. Because if you do, Sachip has said, and other countries will have made progress and you'll be playing catch up. Right? So if you don't want to be one of the innovation followers, if you want to become part of the innovation, I'm not sure what the actual setters or what's the original term, but part of the innovator class, you need to act quickly on this type of opportunities. And the final observation I found fascinating as well is when they say the number of qubits, so the qubit is a small element in quantum computing. If you look at a classical computer, you've got a bit which is 0 or 1. So yes or no, you know, it's two states, right? In quantum computing, it's called a qubit. It can have several different properties. They can influence each other anyway. But it noticed that it's growing at a similar pace as Moore's law. And now D-Wave actually sells, starts taking order for 2,000 qubit computers. So, you know, Moore's law might cease to be relevant with classical computing, but it may very well continue to be relevant within a quantum computing domain. So, here I picked up a number of technologies I found particularly interesting, and postulating that similarly the future has already started. And again, you know, that's not exhaustive, some of you might disagree. What I pointed out about deep learning, autonomous vehicles, blended reality, you can read the slide. Now, I like that quote about autonomous vehicles from Elon Musk, a well-known entrepreneur, again, the Tesla cars, and he described autonomous vehicles, autonomous cars, as a supercomputer with four wheels. It is not the exact quote, right? But something of that nature, that emphasized how important HPC was to this kind of technology. And I think, again, it is something we miss far too often. When I mention high-performance computing or HPC, people just switch off. I say, but that's supercomputing thing, right? No, it's not. I mean, high-performance computing, supercomputers are just the tip of the iceberg. HPC is a methodology, it's an approach to problem-solving, which is about exploiting the computing power of various components. That could be, and I'll come back in a minute, I said, what do all these technology, nine technologies have in common? They need one or more of the following, either to be extremely scalable, being able to address very high throughput, being able to have very low latency. So if you are an autonomous vehicle, you want the decision to be taken in a very timely manner. It's particularly important. One which is very often overlooked is we need to deal with big data, but where big means large and not something else, because far too often I hear big data is not about large volumes of data. Don't believe people say that. It is about big volumes of data. And it is also about energy efficiency. If you think about wearable devices, whether it's mobile device, whether it's wearable devices, like the Google Glasses, whether it is all this wearable computer business, think we need to be energy efficient. If you look at all the sensors in an industry context, Internet of Things, say we need to be energy efficient. Why? Because you want them to last as long as possible with a charge, or maybe you want them to use environmental solar energy or whatever to last if they are in a hostile environment. But what's really interesting is that all these capabilities, how do you achieve that? It's what we call programming for performance. Right? And ultimately, these are the high-performance computing technique. I've got here actually one of my colleagues, Michael Liza, who is heading our Nobel Technologies area, and he's a man who does all the interesting work. Right? I'm just doing the talking, he's doing the doing, which is far more interesting. But it's got very exciting collaborations going on with the likes of Intel, NVIDIA, Data Direct Networks, Xilinx, and so on, where we do just that. Right? And I could give you a few examples. In the medical device, we brought down a diagnostic system from 24 hours to only 4 minutes, right? So now we've got Becton Dickinson, a big medical device company now funding actually the work with Enterprise Ireland to allow us to port this software for one of their medical device prototypes. We did similar achievement with a UK financial services company. Again, we reduced risk calculations from 4 minutes to 1 second. So there are huge applications for a very broad range of domains. The second part is to look at opportunities for Ireland, because I think it's nice to be not to be sitting on the fence, it's better to really be part of the action, right? In my opinion, right, we're living from significant and unparalleled opportunities, but we need to be very agile. Again, as I said, we cannot afford the luxury of thinking about it for 2 years. And we need a multidisciplinary approach, and I will explain later on what I mean by this multidisciplinary approach. Right. We're going for an era of digital transformation, and in my opinion, it's due primarily to the convergence of all these key technologies at the same time. We look at the cloud computing, the Internet of Things, the big data, the analytics, the machine learning, the HPC. We put all that together. All these capabilities together to solve problems. It's actually amazing. Amazing what you can do nowadays. And we had a discussion recently. We coordinated a project on smart agriculture and on flood prevention, flood management, making combination of earth observation from satellite data, from high-resolution computer modeling, and from sensor data on the ground. It is absolutely unbelievable what you can achieve nowadays in terms of precision agriculture. And I think whoever makes the first move on that will draw major dividends. But the other things I wanted to emphasize is the growing role and the growing importance of technologists. So I'm not saying researchers are extremely important, but researchers alone will not bring you the finite, the full package, the full solution. You need to get technologists involved in exploiting this technology efficiently. And last but not least, we have an extremely favorable policy environment, and particularly at the level of the European Commission. So some of you would have noticed that last week we had the celebration of the 60 years of the Treaty of Rome. And we had, as part of this, a digital day. And that's a press release from the European Commission. And you will see that the Commission will bring ministers together tomorrow to progress on high-performance computing, connected mobility, and industry digitization. Right. We've gone a long way now to get HPC recognized as the number one technology here in the digital transformation agenda of the Commission. That's the URL if you wish to have to look at it more closely. You'll find a lot of tweet posts and blogs from Commissioner Oettinger, from Director General Roberto Viola, from the Vice President of the EU. Also, here is very interesting. It's actually a map of a number of European countries which have engaged in this Industry 4 policy agenda. And there is going to be an extra 9 countries joining them very shortly. So there will be a total of 22 or 23 EU countries working together to get this digital transformation across this Industry 4 policy. It's very exciting. So after everything I said earlier, I mean, of course, one of the domains where I think Ireland has a good, should have a go is quantum computing. And it is primarily thanks to our friends from IDA Ireland. Right? Because IDA has been super efficient about all these companies here in Ireland. Both the IBMs and Googles and Microsoft and Intel and Accenture labs are here in our innovation labs as well. The partners from 1 qubit. And, you know, these are the people who are making history, who are making it happen, right? So there's the technology guys here, and I didn't plot underneath, but all the financial services industries, manufacturing, all these other domains which are going to benefit the most from quantum computing are also located here in Ireland. So in my view, it would be very silly not to avail of that ecosystem and do something about it. I mean, these are the four application domains where, you know, we consider basically that quantum computing will make the biggest impact. And of course, Ireland is one of the most respected centers internationally. It's a bit self-serving, but, you know, I have to take this opportunity to plug the fact that we have been recognized among the top five centers in the world by Intel and NVIDIA, right? With Xilinx, we were the only academic center to have their certification in design, and Data Direct Networks, we did work with them as far as Singapore and Saudi Arabia. So that's a truly and genuinely global partnership with those companies. We have demonstrated the ability, certainly, to pick up new technologies very quickly. One final thing I need to say is that I wouldn't have been able to produce all that material on quantum computing without a little help from Mark Garel and his colleagues of Accenture, but I promised that in exchange I would point out that if you are interested in quantum computing, I've got the email address of the person who actually wrote that document, and that you should certainly contact them. They are very interested in hearing about anyone who has interest in exploring quantum computing and what it can do for their business. What Mark mentioned is that they are currently porting, with their partner, they are currently porting in excess of 150 real-life test cases, industry test cases, to a quantum computer. So it's not science fiction, it's happening as we speak. Right? Deep learning is another domain which recently got a lot of publicity. You know, to admit, until a few months ago, I just didn't know what it was, but everybody was talking about it. You know, beating somebody playing Go for the first time was a big thing. And, then they decided to do something maybe a little bit more useful than playing Go, which is to look at detecting eye disease with, I think it was a Royal Free Hospital in London, with the NHS. And I think the data acquisition for mobile phone app, right? And from that, again, they were able to determine, to identify disease in somebody's eye. So, again, I learned through that process, I didn't know about it, that if you suffer from diabetes, you are 25 times more likely to develop blindness. But that if you identify that the problem is coming at a very early stage, in 98% of cases, you can actually avoid the situation, you can control the situation. I think it's fascinating. So this kind of technology can actually save people's sight if used routinely for detection. So I think it's worthy of mention, I could say. That's genuinely useful innovation. Now the second one is to look, I think it was the second collaboration that also was carried out with a different hospital in East London, was looked at huge data sets. Again, so here we make a comparison between Formula One and deep learning. We say big data is a fuel. Without big data, you go nowhere. You're stuck, you're stranded, right? The low precision neural network is a driver, so it's driving the discoveries of the algorithm. And this is your Formula One car. This is a new generation of devices that utilize what we call low precision computing. Right. And you see Google are here, NVIDIA, Intel. Movinius is worth of mention. That's my good friend David Moroney, who is a great Irish entrepreneur, great success, who got bought by Intel a few months ago. It's a great Irish success story, mind you. Right. So basically what you do, you travel with huge amounts of data and your neural networks, you know, we discussed over lunch whether it was a black box or not, is going basically to determine basically give you a verdict as to whether or not particular eye condition is as occurred. What's interesting, there is an apparent contradiction between inexact computing here. Right? Inexact, you spot. I spoke earlier about precision medicine, precision agriculture, and now I'm saying inexact computing. It's a bit of a contradiction, isn't it? Right? So what's happening, in fact, is that, yes, it is inexact in the case of one data set. But remember, you process huge volumes of data. So statistically, the result you get is actually a lot more precise than it should be for a deterministic approach, right? And it means that because you're happy with inexact results, then you can afford to use only a small part of your processor. So in the past, we went to 32-bit, 64-bit processor, increasingly precise calculations. Now we go in the opposite direction, and we got processors who are going to do floating-point operations with commas, floating-point numbers, with only 8. Right? And that's perfectly appropriate for inexact computing. And that gave a boost to Moore's law. Because when you go, say, from double precision to single precision, automatically your device goes twice faster. Right? So you get that boost for free, basically, just by switching to a more lower precision technology. So I think it's very exciting. I was mentioning earlier the conversions of all this technology. This is a good example. The second one I feel very passionate about is precision medicine. And again, it's very interesting for us to remember how far we went and how quickly we went from the invention of the first sequencing machines in the 90s. Right? I was told with the first machine it would have cost several billion to actually get one human genome, right, in several years. In 2000 was the first human genome project completed. And what's been happening here with breakthroughs in terms of innovation since the creation of these high-throughput sequencing machines, we have been able to lower the cost, so this is the cost of 100 million, 10 million, 1 million US dollar, 100K, and so on, we are going towards the 1,000 US dollar genome. It's increasingly close, right, for human beings. It means we'll be able to have the routine use of genome data as part of your medical treatment. But it comes with at a price, though, because when you look at that graph, it does represent the volumes of data generated by this technology. How much storage do you need? How much data is actually generated through those technologies? And here you have three lines. The blue line corresponds to Moore's law. The yellow-orange line represents to the projection from Illumina, who are the leaders in the domain of high-throughput sequencing. And the red one is actually historical trend. And the historical trend say you double the amount of data, the volume of data, every 7 months. Right? So give you a sense, again, of how much our requirements are going on. I didn't need to mention that because when we go to our funders, we make a case for certain equipment, and there's always a sense that the check has been signed, you've got your equipment, just go away, you probably won't need anything else for the next 5 years. I said, well, not quite, because technology goes so fast that equipment is actually becoming obsolescent within only 2 to 3 years. That's unfortunately what we are. But HPC in precision medicine is interesting. So many people, again, do not understand why HPC, why data management. With a huge volume of data to process, you need to get a very high level of processing capability. Right? Under the old model, you went somewhere, you downloaded the data, you processed it. Now it's finished. The data is too large to move. So what you do, you move the computation where the data is. Right? So it's a different model. But also, we did realize that the way we did medicine in the past, right? Say you had routinely we prescribed, say, aspirin to people with some kind of heart problems and so on, right? So the type of treatment was based on average efficacy of a drug for the population, right? And the dosage you received very much depends on the advice of the chief medical officer. So what country you live in, right? Now we do a far more personalized approach with precision medicine, for example. You got a number of typical cancers have different strands, have different mutations. So the first thing you would do is to identify the genome for a particular tumor, to see what kind of tumors are you actually affected with. Then you look at the genome for the patient as well, right? And with all those different analyses, you are able to identify a therapy which is going to be optimal for the person, for the patients, and hopefully with far more positive outcome. But you need integration of infrastructure, that's HPC data and lab equipment, institutions, from the clinicians and so on, research lab, technologists and so on. You also need data protection oversight, which is very important. And you need the expertise as well. Okay, so I think that's a slide I'm particularly passionate about. So next one, I go back to what I was saying earlier, so I won't read it again because it's pretty much repeating what I was saying about these two collaborations between Google and NHS hospitals. The first one, the Royal Free Hospital, the second one, Moorfield High Hospital. The only thing I would mention about this one, right, is they have the largest repository, tube repository, of optical coherence OCT tomographic data scans in the world. And they shared with Google, I am told, about 1 million anonymous digital eye scans with related information about the course of treatment and whatever other relevant information about the patient, history of the patient. But that's a thought in terms of the ability of legislation to keep up. And the first one in particular caused a lot of controversy, and people were openly criticizing the press, the right of the NHS, the right of the hospital to share this data with Google. I think there is a natural anxiety at the prospect of private data being in the hands of big bad multinational corporations, right? Most of us are a bit fearful about that. Why are they doing this? Right? What's the motivation? And this was a response at the time that was given by the hospital. So they just followed standard policy in terms of sharing data with third-party organizations. Now, is that appropriate or not? What's very interesting is that for the second collaboration, the data were anonymized and there was no such public protests in terms of Google working together with the hospital. But what's very interesting is how to strike the balance between the right to privacy and public interest, right? And in the UK, they have that very interesting report. It's called the UK Caldecott Principle, and I like very much the seventh principle, which is the duty to share information can be as important as the duty to protect patient confidentiality. Now, I don't know too much about this, so if you have any questions about Caldecott, that's my colleague Emma here in the corner, is looking after our public sector collaborations, worked very closely with the Central Statistics Office and with the Health Research Board. Emma could tell you all about this technical principle. What I wanted to point out in passing, however, is that the function of what we call this trusted third-party data processor function in Scotland is actually fulfilled by their national high-performance computing centre, a place called EPSRC, where I used to work, right? So again, it demonstrates the validity of using HPC for these approaches. And these are my final two slides, because I realize it's getting warm and everybody's feeling a bit, maybe a little bit like having a siesta. We need to be strategic. I said please. So that's not a requirement, but I just hope. Are we ready? So there are some good and not so good. Mm. Yes, we do have a robust platform or not. Absolutely. We have innovation-driven policies. It goes without saying, I think Innovation 2020 demonstrates the importance of innovation in national policy. And we have very strong industry links, both with the remarkable work of IDEA Ireland and Enterprise Ireland. So certainly, I think, it's our strong position. But in my opinion, and it's a personal view, there are a number of key structural issues. And the way I see it, the danger with prioritization-based policies, it can lead to a silo mentality or unnecessary silo of research and development. That's part of the problem. And also underfunding of platform science and technology. And for me, that's a key problem. So then, if you look at all these emerging domains I mentioned earlier, quantum computing, precision medicine, or deep learning stuff and so on, you need technologies to work hand in hand with domain specialists. Sometimes domain specialists from multiple domains. So if you start putting in place a system that tries to partition, isolate, and create silos, in my opinion, this is counterproductive. What's even more counterproductive is to ignore the platform science technology and infrastructure. And so my second difficulty here is a chronic underinvestment in national infrastructure. And I think what would be very useful here is to have some level of routine benchmarking of high-performance computing and data management infrastructure per capita compared to other European countries. And I think that's a well-known fact that we currently have 6 UK universities with more computational power for their own university individually than we have for the country as a whole. And I don't think that's a normal situation. I don't think this is causing a lot of difficulties to people who rely on processing power to carry out their business. For example, I think another example was the lack of availability for a platform for data management. I think, again, it's a mystery to me, means that this is certainly slowing down progress in our observation of learning, precision medicine, climate modeling. I can name some but a few. Most companies, I cannot give names, when they come to see me, the first thing they say is, do you have very large data sets? Why? Because they want to do machine learning, and they want to do deep learning. You don't do deep learning, I was going to say, on a floppy disk, right, on a USB stick. You need much larger data sets, right? Hundreds of terabytes, petabytes. Where do you put them if you don't have an infrastructure to store this data? I'd love to ask that question, particularly with big data analytics being regarded as a priority. Right? It's a mystery to me. Infrastructure is not just about equipment. Infrastructure is about software, and more importantly, it's about people. So in my view, the funding vehicles should take care of addressing infrastructure as a whole, including its running costs, including the software, including the people. Right? All too often are on this side. And I think the role and importance of technologies should not be misunderstood. And I think if you want those guys, like my colleagues here, to work hand in hand effectively with domain specialists, clinicians, whatever it is, you know, in industry or academia, we need access to opportunities, to funding, but we also need parity of esteem. And the problem with the academic world, I hope I don't offend too many people, but it is one of the last remaining caste systems. It is a caste system, right? So you are career academic, or you are the riffraff, you are the technician. Right? A glorified technician, as somebody called me once, right? But that's a problem, because you don't form high-performing teams without respect. Mm-hmm. And that's the last slide. Key recommendations, I kept it to three. I think we should consider seriously introducing a top-down approach to national infrastructure funding. And I've seen somebody here from the Department of the T-Shop, so maybe that's my one polite request. We need an approach which caters for cross-departmental, cross-agency initiatives. Right? Because I think, to my mind, as a taxpayer, it wouldn't make sense to fund a data management infrastructure, computing power, a different one for agriculture, a different one for jobs, a different one for education, a different one for each government department. It just doesn't make any sense. Right? These needs are cross-departmental, and you achieve considerable economies of scale, not only in terms of the hardware, but the software infrastructure in terms of deployment and operation. So we need that big time. And I know it is happening. In fairness, the government recently visited the data center of the revenue commissioners. Mm. And I was delighted to see that all the equipment has the little badge from each government department. And you find pretty much every single government department, you find it was the prison services, you had revenue commissioners, all the state agencies together understood the benefit of investing in a state-of-the-art data center, right, and sharing the same infrastructure. So there is good understanding in that domain of the benefits of connecting the dots and having a cross-departmental approach. We also need such infrastructure to be robust, near mission critical, and multidisciplinary. Right? Robust why? Because if you want to use it to deliver public services, if you want to use it as a platform of collaboration with industry, it needs to be 24/7. It cannot be your best effort, or my student will look after it. Right? It's just not good enough. Right? So we've been operating the national weather forecasting for over 10 years. We know how to do this kind of business. We'll be very happy to help if we are offered the opportunity. Multidisciplinary at two different levels, because the current approach tends to lead to a balkanization of resources. And again, as I said, if you start distributing infrastructure funding across several universities because you are concerned with your popularity with the university sector, it's not a good approach. But also because there are genuine benefits of bringing together data sets from various disciplines within the same infrastructure. Greatly facilitates. You look at transport, weather, or climate and health, and so on and so forth. You can look at clear correlation between say, climate and the development of certain conditions like respiratory disease and so on, or transport, for example, and so on. If you start by putting them all over the place, flooding is a good example, right? Flooding, we did the calculation once, you need almost, I think, about 10 different data sources for an efficient flood modeling system. Right? I mean, again, if they all reside under the same infrastructure, it's much easier to deploy models operation models. The second one is the need to introduce programs to support HPC technologies. Again, it's a bit self-serving, I apologize for that, but I think it's a good platform to hope you allow me a bit of self-serving promotion. But there is a significant opportunity for the country in terms of training education. There is going to be a huge demand before too long for people who know how to exploit these kind of technologies very effectively. And again, that's something not only to look at the third level sector, but also something to look younger age. And I think there are some very good initiatives in this domain. I heard about some initiatives from Google earlier over lunch, so thank you, Google, for that. That's certainly the kind of initiatives we are looking to see adopted. And the need to bring this parity OSTM, I come back to it again, which is maybe reconsidering certain eligibility criteria that places us outside of funding models and the way in which applications are being reviewed. And the final one, I think, we have a need to strengthen processes. We can always do better, no matter how good what we do is. We always need to do better, to look at improving what we do. And my feeling in terms of policy implementation is that we could greatly benefit from the creation of an international strategic advisory network. I participated in such groups in the UK for a good few years, and that allows to make sure that whatever awareness of technology is going to be found, is it for real? Do we need to be responsible? What's happening in other countries, that we're connected to the rest of the world and not taking our decision in vacuum? Right, so that's good. And the final one, really, is I would also be very keen on seeing a position of chief technology officer to the government being created. We saw the benefits of creating the position of CIO to the government, there's no doubt. We all understand the benefits of what a good chief scientific advisor can do in that domain as well. But I think technology is sufficiently, in some domains, sufficiently distinct from science, in my view, that it deserves to get somebody really in charge of his brief. And somebody, I would add, with a long track record in industry and a long track record of innovation would be even better if we could secure the participation of such a person. Well, I hope I wasn't too controversial.
No, well, yes, you were.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tracy.